Revolution Radio proudly presents, live from the heart of the Blue Ridge, Roanoke, Virginia. It's the Just Bernard Show with host Bernard Alvarez. Join Bernard as he shares topics that reveal the real matrix and empower your human experience, including world liberty, the esoteric, suppressed technologies, spiritual ascension, and human consciousness. Humanity has awakened, and our time has come to realize our full potential. And now, live from the Star City, your host, Bernard Alvarez.
Without further ado, let me tell you a little bit about my guest who's joining me today. Gordon Asher Davidson has had a long career of active leadership in social change institutions and movements, while simultaneously pursuing a deep inner meditative life, culminating in his book, The Transfiguration of Our World, How a Light Alliance is Transforming Darkness and Creating a New Earth. His experience includes co-authoring with his wife, Corrine McLaughlin, The Practical Visionary and Spiritual Politics, with a foreword written by the Dalai Lama, co-founding Sirius, a spiritual environmental community, serving as founding director of the Social Investment Forum, founding and co-directing a Washington, D.C. institute, the Center for Visionary Leadership, and offering many clients worldwide deep spiritual guidance and transformational consulting for over 20 years. So without further ado, let me welcome Gordon to the Just Bernard Show. Hello, Gordon. How are you today?
Oh, I'm very well, Bernard. Thank you so much for having me on your show.
I'm really glad. I'm really glad you're here, and I've been looking forward to this talk for several weeks now. So thank you for being here today.
Thank you. Yes, it's a pleasure.
Wonderful. So you have had quite a bit of experience in this part of working for humanity, and I can't help but wonder what was the motivating factor to get you started on this path of supporting humanity and the awakening.
Well, if I go really back to the very, very big beginnings, I would say when I was very young, I must have been about 8 years old, I had this very powerful spiritual experience where I experienced myself as one with all of life. And this was out in nature, in a beautiful field with flowers and butterflies. And I was very young, and I just had this transcendent experience where I was one with everything, literally. And it went all the way throughout the earth and into the cosmos. And that was extremely formative for me to realize that I am not a separate being. I am part of all, and we all are part of all.
Yeah.
And that was very fundamental to my whole life. And so my path has always been to pursue, well, what does that mean? How do I contribute? Well, how can I best make a difference and help people realize this reality, which is the truth? And so I was very involved in social activism when I was at the university. I was the editor of the newspaper. I was very active in anti-apartheid and saving the environment and many, many issues. And I went to India in the Peace Corps. I spent 2.5 years working with farmers in villages, which was an extraordinary experience. Mm. And really life-changing, for sure. And I was in the Peace Corps. And then I came back and started exploring every spiritual tradition, every type of meditation practice and everything for many, many years, and finally got deeply into esoteric meditation and practice. I've been practicing that since 1972 and have had a multitude of experiences working with meditation and in many, many inner experiences which have led me to actually have a contact with a being on the inner planes who is very, very deeply engaged at a very high level with the process of unfolding this higher evolutionary process for humanity. And actually, I've been working with for 20 years with detailed guidance and information being given to me to use to bring it out into the world, create projects, and also, especially in the last 2 or 3 years, I was given a lot of information about what is happening on the Earth, why is everything in the condition it is, and where is it all going, in order to share that with the world. And I've done that with multiple teleseminars, and I finally was convinced to put out a book on it, even though it was somewhat a big leap outside of my comfort zone. And people ask me about my comfort zone. I say, I don't even know what if I have a comfort zone anymore.
No, I know.
And that book has been out now since September of last year, and it's doing extremely well. And it's been profoundly positively received by everyone who reads it. And the word is spreading by word of mouth primarily, although I do have some people helping me. And it's going really well.
That's fantastic. Wow. I can't help but hear a parallel of what you're saying of the timeline of your experience and your practice and everything that happened to you with so many of us here on the planet. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that there's some kind of spontaneous I don't want to say spontaneous awakening, it's become very cliche, but I guess that would be the best way to say it, that many of us seem to be having this inner profound connection that seems to be needing to be heard at this time on the planet. What are your thoughts on that?
Oh, yes, absolutely so. And I wrote about this in some length in my book about why it's become easier and easier for people to make these internal connections with higher levels of consciousness and beings, because that is happening on a very wide scale all over the world, for sure. And it's really about the fact that there is a large increase in the amount of light and love and positive vision that's being radiated to humanity, being directly communicated to us from all these other levels of consciousness that are, you know, beyond our Earth, that are really very important to our evolution. They're assisting us and supporting us. And I talk a lot about that, and I can give more detail if you'd like about why this has shifted so much and what is going on with this whole process, because it's very, very, very fundamental to what's happening on the planet. We are going through this tremendous up-leveling of our vibrational frequency on the planet. There's no doubt about that. Mm-hmm. And people can testify to that from their own experience, from the energies they're working with the fact that spiritual work now is accelerating, it's easier now to do things, you know. And at the same time, as the energies increase, internal to our own energy field, all the blockages and resistances that we, you know, have in our systems are being brought to light for us to process and release. So, of course, that is also going on at the same time. So it does create challenges for people, but they're all challenges of raising our consciousness and level of energy so we can function at these new higher order frequencies.
Oh, and I can relate to that.
Yes,
it's amazing how some of these, and I think that's what's so important about the work that people like yourself and myself are doing, and so many thousands of others on the planet probably, mm-hmm. that we're helpful during these traumatic experiences, because it is quite traumatic for many people. It sometimes becomes moments of crisis within their life, mm-hmm. a letting go of old way of thinking, letting go of old labels, letting go of the ego of how they saw themselves and what their belief is and what our belief is on our life. So it can be very traumatic, and I feel
right.
It's so important for people like yourself to be out there sharing experiences and giving the support that's needed.
Right. I can share with you an experience, if you like, of the biggest letting go experience I've had in my life. Would you like to hear that?
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you.
So my wife and I we started a spiritual community in Massachusetts called Sirius, which is still going very well and beautiful. It's very ecological and very spiritual. And many programs and things go on there in Massachusetts. And we lived there for 14 years, and then we started going to Washington, D.C., and working in that city. And we had a lot of response to what we were offering, and we were going back and forth between the two cities. two locations. And ultimately, at a certain point after being in Washington, which I found to be a difficult place to be energetically, I decided we were going to move back to our community and our beautiful solar house that I built myself and live there. And that would be our life. And when our book, Spiritual Politics, was coming out. And so we took all of our things, moved them back to our house. And 2 months later, an arsonist burned our house to the ground and everything in it. And so it was very, very traumatic for me, of course, and for both of us. And so we then went on our 40-city book tour and did that. We didn't even have any clothes. We had to go out and buy clothes go out. It was a very intense experience. And I was, of course, quite upset and angry in the sense of God. You know, why did this happen? Why did you allow this? I mean, we're doing good spiritual work. We're good people. Why did you do this, you know? To us. And this was a very intense thing that went on for about almost a year. And finally, I realized at a certain point after that period that we had moved everything back to our community because I wanted to be there. I didn't want to be in Washington. Meanwhile, my wife, Corrine, had been getting that we should stay in Washington and open a center there and do more work there. And I didn't want to do that. And so we went back, and I followed my will, my idea. We went back, and the house was burned to the ground.
Oh, my gosh.
We went back to Washington and lived with a friend there. And in that process, I came to realize that the issue was my self-will. Speaking of ego, you know, it's self-will. Mm-hmm, I'm going to do what I want the way I want it, and nobody's going to tell me. So I went through a very deep process of releasing my self-will. Really, and asking that I be guided by the higher will. It was a very intense, and it took many months. But in the end, I really, really did it, and I really meant it. And at that point is when I had this opening to one of the masters who began to communicate with me about all the possibilities and what had happened and why. And basically, out of that communication, we were asked to start a center, not asked, but shown the possibility of starting a center in Washington, which we did, called the Center for Visionary Leadership, which we did for 7 years, and we had a pretty significant impact on Washington, D.C., bringing all spiritual programs and speakers. We did huge courses for years on connecting to the soul and all this. So it was learning to let go of personal will and seeing how wonderful the results were when I did that.
Mm-hmm.
And that relationship has continued ever since, and that is the source that I receive from about all the things that I've shared in my book and other projects that I've started and have running successfully based on that inner connection.
I can't help but think about how wonderful it must have been to have all that energy in Washington and hopefully resonate outward.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Oh, we did. We ran conferences, major national conferences on spirit and business, spirit and politics. We had major speakers, you know, John Hagelin and Ralph Nader and everybody we could get, and senators and congresspeople. We did all kinds of major programs in Washington, D.C., brought many well-known New Age people to Washington as well. And we definitely had quite an impact. And our book, Spiritual Politics, was given to every member of Congress. And we know that Tim Worth, one of President Clinton's appointees, carried the book around with him for 6 months reading it. So we know that it really, and Al Gore and others, so we know that it was out there and did have an impact.
Oh, good. Well, it'd be nice to start seeing the results of that now.
Yeah, let's hope to start to see it. You know, it's been a long process.
Absolutely, and you know what? And actually, this is a very good point. I'd like to bring up, if we could talk about that for just a moment. The idea of this, the transformation, the transfiguration of our world, on this particular 3.5D timeline, whatever we consider ourselves in, or even just on time and timeline. So many of us get very frustrated because we want to see the golden age of humanity. We want to be here for that. And who's not to say that, you know, we won't come back for it, but I feel there's a certain restraint that's called for, and understanding that it's okay if it doesn't happen in our lifetime, that as long as we continue to work toward this and allowing the energy to move through. Have you been given any information on timeline or anything relating to what I just spoke about?
Oh, yes, a great deal of information, and that's what's in my book. I think it'd be useful. I mean, one of the things that is helpful to understand of why it's been so slow to evolve and to make this move into the new civilization we all long for in our hearts is to understand what the resistance is. And I want to share some very good news with your people about what's happening and how that resistance is being neutralized, because it's very, very significant in our whole process. Okay? Does that sound good?
Yes.
So our Earth is obviously part of a larger whole. It's part of the galaxy, and there has been a very long struggle within our galaxy with the light forces of light and dark for long periods of time. But ultimately, in our galaxy, the Light Alliance, a group of lighted civilizations who basically honor the principle of freedom and self-chosen development and evolution, and friendly relations between all races and civilizations, have won the day. And that is the overriding power in our galaxy at this point. It's called the Galactic Light Alliance. And it is all those civilizations who have basically that intent and that purpose. So we've had this struggle for that, but we are now in that place. However, there were some darker forces, alien forces, that got into our planet very early stage of our development, millennia ago, and were able to gain entrance, and it was decided by the higher levels of consciousness that they would be allowed to stay and remain on our planet so that humanity would be given the choice between choosing the path of selfishness and greed and all that, or the path of light. And by making those choices, we would learn from the karma of our choices and learn to make better choices. That was really the idea. And so that has been, and that has been going on for a very long time on our planet. And they gained, these forces, the darker forces, gained a lot of control over all of our systems on the planet. And meanwhile, the spiritual masters and other lighted beings came to Earth, shared the teaching of light and love and, you know, service and giving to others as a way, that a path to present to humanity, and many, many people have chosen that path, but many have not as well. Many have aligned themselves with these darker patterns of selfishness. Right. And so we have these two forces or two energies here on our planet, have for a very long time. World War II was another attempt by the dark forces to fully take over the planet and really turn it into a slave kind of situation.
Yeah.
They were defeated by the light forces, and even the galactic civilizations helped the allies to win that war by helping to hold that spiritual point of focus longer and stronger than the dark side. So, but they've been very active even after the war, although many of the human cooperators were neutralized. They've still been present on the planet, and they've reorganized and they recreated their systems and gained full control over the financial system, great deal of influence over the political and media and all the rest of it, which is why it's been so difficult to bring out these, you know, see the good news and see what's happening on the planet. It's just so distorted, the picture that's presented, which is deliberate because they're trying to keep people in fear, which makes them easier to control.
Yep.
However, so their final biggest plan that they had was basically the event we all call 9/11. And 9/11 was an orchestrated event, as anyone who does any research will discover if you didn't check into that. And it was intended to create fear, control, and they did get the Patriot Act, and they did invade the Middle East because they thought they were going to be able to establish control over all that oil and all the rest of it. That didn't work out so well. But they did get the Patriot Act, and they did exercise a certain more additional control. That was, 9/11 was one of the most significant events in our human history. You know, I'll not tell you why it's so. Not for the reasons people would think. So this, what happened after 9/11 showed that they were at a point where they really were getting close to totally controlling everything on the planet. And now we have to shift perspective and look at, here's planet Earth, and it is in located within the body of the solar system, right? It's one of the planets. And every planet in the solar system is a chakra in the body of the solar system.
Yeah.
And the solar being and the solar system itself has been ready to progress and move onward in its evolution for a long time. And it's been waiting for the light to finally, you know, become the primary energy field on our Earth and be able to move, because the solar being cannot progress if one of its chakras is all controlled by the dark.
Yeah.
It's like you trying to grow and you have one chakra that's a total mess. It's going to be very difficult. And so they looked at the situation on Earth. They saw the control that the dark side had been able to create through 9/11 and all the other things. And at the level of the Solar Council, a decision was made that it was now time to remove the dark forces from our planet. And that was in 2002. And what the way they did this was they gave the galactic civilizations, of which there are hundreds of them, in focusing on our planet, there are millions and billions, but on our planet, focusing on our planet, probably more than hundreds, but a lot of them.
Right.
And they gave them permission to remove the original 50 aliens who came into the planet and set up the dark control system. They have been removed or turned to the light. They are gone. And they had certain capacities. They could exercise a degree of telepathic control over humanity. They had certain prevision of the future. There was various things they could do, which made it, and they knew how to set up these exploitive kind of systems, like the financial system that we have with interest-based money and all the rest of it. They were taken off. They've been taken off the planet. They're gone. But it still leaves a huge number of human beings who have been part of their systems and cooperating with them for all the wonderful perks they get as a result. So the other thing that was the Galactics were given permission to do was increase the amount of light that they could radiate to humanity, to the planet, to the Earth, in all levels. And they have been steadily increasing that since 2002. That is one of the core reasons why, as we started out this conversation, why the light is increasing on our Earth. Because the Galactics have been given permission to radiate more and more light to the Earth. In addition to that, they are also steadily having more and more direct contact, and not necessarily physically showing up, but communication through on the inner levels with many, many people on the planet, and sharing with them what the plan is of how the Earth is meant to unfold, what is going on to, you know, absorb the dark and bring more light to the planet. And that Galactic Light Alliance has now built many, many lines of communication and cooperation, co-creation with many human beings on the planet, including major leaders on our Earth. And that is in process. It's very dynamically in process. And I can give you lots of evidence of how that's so. Of course, one of the primary control systems is the financial.
Yeah.
And that's how, through the interest-based money and controlling, everyone gets into debt. You have, and everybody's got huge debt because you can't get yourself out of debt when you're paying interest on money circulating through the system. It's just impossible. So what they're doing, there is a fully developed plan on how we are going to move out of that financial system into one where there is no more interest-based money, there is no more interest on loans, and there will be a whole new currency which will function without interest. And there are many, many people now inside the systems who are actively engaged in creating the framework and structure for this to be put into place. It's very
wonderful.
And now, back to your host, Bernard Alvarez.
And welcome back to the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. We're having a very, very interesting discussion with Gordon Asher Davidson. And before the break, Gordon, you were talking about the financial system and how, and the controlling the controlling of humanity through it, and how it's changing. Can you tell us a little bit more about this particular aspect of what the information that you're receiving on it?
Yes, certainly. Many of the world's leaders, including some heads of state, have been aware for a long time about the way that the financial powers manipulate the system itself for their own benefit, the way anyone who opposes or exposes this kind of activity often is intimidated or even killed. They have been aware of the way the very damaging effects that they can orchestrate against a country that opposes them. It's just been an ongoing recognition by many people, but leaders did not know what to do, how to deal with this, because even they could be under threat. And what has happened is, through the connection with the Galactic Alliance, there has been more a coordination has been created between the leaders in the world who are concerned about this, know about it, are concerned about the well-being of humanity, and there are many, many of them. And that has been woven into what's called the Earth Light Alliance, which is in direct contact and is being supported by energetically and with overall vision and ideas by the Galactic Light Alliance. So there's a whole new sort of melding or blending of those two groups into one huge, powerful energy field on our planet that is working for the liberation of Earth. And that is very active. And so they have a plan, a clear plan, on how they want to do this, which is to do with changing and restructuring the entire financial system. That means refounding the banking system under very rigorous rules so that banks serve the circulation of funds and resources and promote fair exchange and economic activity. It means establishing a new currency, which is gold-backed or backed with other commodities, and issued by a completely trustworthy international group, and the distribution of funds and resources to provide for the needs of every human being on the planet. The banks will be rechartered with strict rules regarding their operations, including loans and other functions. Rather than being able to charge endless interest on a loan, they would just be able to charge a fee based on the size of the loan, but there would be no interest. There would also be no interest on money being put into circulation to, you know, allow economic transactions. So, and the amount of money in the system would be carefully regulated to promote positive economic exchanges. Banks would become, rather than profit-making companies owned by a few families, would be operated like a public utility, so that they actually would be, serving the interests of the whole and regulated and overseen by people who do have the interests of the whole at heart and are not corruptible, which is the key point.
Yeah.
And then there will be a worldwide distribution of funds and systems established to build new Earth-sensitive infrastructure to meet the basic needs of everyone in the world for food, shelter, housing, sanitation, healthcare, education, and opportunities to make a creative contribution. And there will be a real education for people on who we all really are as divine beings in a human form who are meant to be creators. That's the highest expression. One of the highest expressions of our divinity is being a creator, creating, and learning that we can do this just like the God of this planet created this planet. Okay, so we can create too, and people are creating more and more. So, and this will lead, of course, to political reforms because the money system allows the control of the political system right now, and all those who have been aligned with what's popularly known as the cabal, which is the group, the controlling group, will be removed or re-educated. And this whole process of how people are able to come into the government and stand for election will be very different. We will have very rigorous criteria, and people will only will be allowed to stand who can have proven that they have the well-being and good of the people they represent in as their motivation, rather than their ego, self-aggrandizement, making themselves wealthy, and all the other crazy stuff that goes on in government right now. All that will be eliminated. That is definitely the vision. And so there's, you know, and I know that for some people this may sound like a complete fantasy, and how could this ever come about? Also, the media needs to be transformed.
Yeah.
So that we actually can have lighted information that tells us the truth about what's going on, rather than being fed all this nonsense controlled by the cabal, the dark, the controlling forces, that are always trying to inspire fear and control and, you know,
divisiveness.
Divisiveness and an image that the human being is corruptible, evil, dangerous, and therefore you don't trust anybody.
Yeah.
You know, that makes the whole control process easier to maintain. So that's all going to be changed. So, and now I realize this sounds like a lot of, oh my, how is this ever going to happen? But I'll give you a couple of examples of how this is already happening. Of course, one of the things people don't know is there have been, over the last 2.5 years, over 2,000 CEOs, CFOs, and top-level executives in banks, hedge funds, mutual funds, and financial institutions all over the world who have either been, have resigned, been indicted, have died, or disappeared. Over 2,000
wow.
worldwide. And that is, and people have done a statistical analysis of this, it's 10 times the norm of the turnover rate at that high level of, you know, executive suite.
Wow.
So that is a very major indicator that there's something going on in the financial system. And in most cases, those people are being replaced by people who are lighted individuals who are working for the good of the whole. That is happening. And it hasn't fully manifested with major changes in the system yet, but the groundwork is being laid very steadily and clearly for this new system. And so there's always, you know, but now the question you originally started with, which is what about the timing, which is really, as you can imagine, trying to do this major reorganization of the entire world system is an extraordinarily complex matter. And there are so many factors involved that it takes a lot to organize and orchestrate all this. However, this is accelerating in the dynamics of it so that it is moving forward very steadily and surely, and there's no question about that. And I can give you many, many more examples of, and I will if you like, of how this is happening. And yet it has to have a certain readiness of all of the different things that have to be put in place before the actual thing can be initiated. And now there's another whole dimension to it, which is going to be brought into play at the time when this is initiated. And some people, other people besides myself, have gotten this information, that they're at the level of the solar being, there is going to be at a certain time when it's considered that everything is in readiness, there will be a release of higher frequency love energy to the planet, a gigantic wave of higher energy that will come onto the planet, which will allow people to move into the frequency of love and realize that that is fundamentally what we are and what is the core of the energy of the universe is love.
Yeah.
That's it. And everybody who has any ability to understand or open at all in any way to love will be able to adjust to that frequency and move in with it. And be able to, and it will open up a realization of that we are fundamentally one, as all life on this planet. Now, those people who really can't do that, who do not understand that love is a fundamental, that they just have no openness in them and are consumed by all the hatred and separation and violence and all those things, they will not be able to remain on this planet. the energy frequency will be so powerful that their system will not be able to adjust to be here. And they will move off the planet, and they will be placed in other environments, other realms, where they can continue their evolution at a frequency level that's appropriate and resonates with their own. That is part of the plan. And other people have talked about this. I'm not the only one who's getting this information. And people call it the tsunami of love. They call it the event. They call it lots of things. But what my source calls it is the day of revelation. Because not only will all this happen energetically, but there will be a revealing of what's really going on this planet and has gone on for a very long time with all the control systems. And also, what is this new plan that's being put forward and put into place to really liberate us from this control? That all will be brought forward in a very direct and open way through worldwide media channels. That's all going to be part of the process.
And we're all looking forward to that, too.
Aren't we, though? Yes, indeed. And, of course, when that's going to happen is not known. It's not even known by the spiritual masters,
right?
Because its timing is determined at a very, very high level, at the level of the solar system, but that it is very clear that I have received, and others, and my contact with the master has told me very clearly that this is definitely in underway, and they are simply continuing to prepare and gain and put all the systems in place and prepare the groups and people to know about what the plan is. And they, from what I understand, they even have the new programs for running the financial system on this new basis have already been installed on the financial systems of the world. They're not activated, but they're present. They're already there.
Wow.
They're just waiting for the timing, the signal, which everybody knows they have to wait until it's the right moment. But that is in place, and it is all being prepared. And every day that passes, more and more people are waking up, and they are moving into higher consciousness, realizing that this, how in unsustainable and corrupt our entire system we have is, and that we have to have something new. And that's part of the purpose of all the revelations, all the whistleblowers, who, God bless them, are bringing out this information about what's really going on, often at the risk or even the cost of their lives, but they are doing this. And that helps humanity get to the point of consciousness to realize this system is not salvageable in its current form. It has to be completely transformed and ultimately transfigured. That is the growing recognition within more and more members of humanity. Now, in the meantime, the cabal is doing everything it can to try to keep the system going, manipulate the financial system, desperately trying to keep it going. But one of the things that's happened is because that leadership at the very top level of the cabal was removed, they don't have the same kind of direct orders coming in or what to do and how to plan and how to manipulate the system or understanding how things are going to unfold. They don't have that anymore. That's why things have gotten even more chaotic.
Yeah.
Because they don't have that level of higher vision, or even though it's a dark vision, they don't have it anymore.
It's not unified. So now it seems they're turning on each other,
Exactly. Because everybody's trying to protect themselves, and they're trying to figure out how they can possibly survive, and many of them are actually turning towards the light, because they're always offered that opportunity by the Light Alliance constantly, and there are negotiations ongoing. There are opportunities for them to continue to serve in their positions if they reorient themselves, and many are choosing to do so. That's another part of the transformation that's happening, and you can see that showing up with various figures in different positions.
Well, it's amazing to me because you're giving us examples of the things that are going to be changing, and I can't help but see on a small level how things are changing with, let's say, like alternative media or cooperative organizations instead of corporations or cooperative, I don't know if you want to call it a socialized business, so many different new models are coming along, and people are starting to apply them And I guess, the best way for me to say it is that people are going inside to receive these new paradigms, receiving these new models of living, and are being courageous enough to put them into application, whether it be in their own lives or in their community. I know here and locally, I'm seeing a lot of cooperative type businesses. A lot of for profits are now becoming nonprofit. And even within my own personal life, I had a very, we were talking about that crisis moment. I think we all go through little epiphanies and crises in our spiritual growth. But I went through one several weeks ago dealing with finances. And I've always, my entire life, I've always felt there was something wrong about the monetary system. I loved money. I actually came from, a comfortable life and made lots of money in my youth. And I loved to spend it. But there was always something that I did not want to participate in the financial networks. I never really tried to make money. A couple of weeks ago, my guides came to me in my dreams and said, it's okay to admit you do not wish to have money in your life. There's, I guess the way to explain it for me was that do what you love, do what you're supposed to be doing, and you will be taken care of. Instead of going for the dollars, go for the energy exchange, in other words.
Yes.
And I changed my entire way of thinking. I was like, I'm not going to run my work as a business. I'm going to run it as an art of creation. Mm-hmm. And if I get something in return, that's wonderful. If I don't, I'm still going to keep doing what I'm doing, even if I'm living in the woods, But
absolutely. That's very beautiful. And that's been my experience as well. My wife and I, we met and lived for several years in the Fintorn community in Scotland. And that was one of the principles was, you do what is your highest understanding of your purpose first. And that put your purpose, your connection to spirit first.
Yes.
And everything will flow from that. And that has been the way we've lived our lives, and that has been true for us, absolutely. And everything has worked out for us in the most extraordinary ways, and it continues to do that. And, so I totally resonate with this, and I know how big an issue this is for so many people because, if you're doing spiritual work, at this moment in the financial structure, it doesn't get a lot of reward financially. Of course, spiritually and in your heart, you get a lot of satisfaction out of doing good work, and that's most important. It is the most important thing. But but we also need to sustain ourselves in the world. That's an issue that we all have to deal with. And I think that, what I've personally gone through is that, and because of past lives where we've had a lot of training maybe or experience in monasteries and ashrams where, the whole idea of money was considered, somehow tainting and something to avoid. And, you didn't need, and if you had money, you would be spiritually compromised. All that has been part of our history for many, many of us, especially people who have spiritual inclination. Mm-hmm. So it's very important, I think, to change that and to realize, yes, you can be overtaken by money if you make that your God, your number one value. But if you learn how to manage it as a resource, as an energy that you simply use to help you fulfill your soul purpose, your higher purpose, and accept that at a subconscious level, because most of this dynamic about money for spiritual people goes on at the subconscious level. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when people actually can change that, that really makes a huge difference in the way money flows in your life. That's part of the reason why I got so deeply into subconscious work over the last 10 years. I did a lot of study, and I worked with various people who I learned a lot from about the subconscious and really been... And I've been practicing. Well, I did a great deal of work on my own subconscious, and then I've been working with people for over 10 years with deep, deep subconscious transformation so that those patterns that from the past no longer limit us. They can be changed. And that's a very, very important part of being able to work with these new energies that are flowing in, because the subconscious is, in a sense, a limiting factor if it's blocking you from, you know, being able to implement what you receive from a higher level.
And I love what you're saying about the subconscious, because when I was dealing with my my situation several weeks ago, it was almost as if the very thought up until several weeks ago, I was the empowerment director for a global organization, and we were going to become a nonprofit, and you know, it was a very very big a big responsibility for me, and mm-hmm. we dissolved it after I had this moment. I was like, you know what, I can't do this like this anymore. Because I felt that, speaking on a subconscious level, that when I was prioritizing the fundraising mechanisms or prioritizing, you know, the bank accounts or whatnot, it did create an energetic block.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
when I looked at it, like, okay, well, I have to be the responsible, you know, executive director, and I have to look at the accounts and this and that.
Sure.
It was very energetically blocking for me.
Mm-hmm.
And just by letting that go, it felt very freeing. And again, like you said, having your work be the highest calling and allowing that energy to flow, I firmly believe that universe and, you know, our light brothers and sisters are going to make sure that the work that you're doing can continue. Mm-hmm. And the people that are supporting you are going to make sure that your work can continue, whether it be buying your book or, you know, donating to your website or whatever it may be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we got to take a short break and we'll be right back. I'm really enjoying our talk today with Gordon Ashford Davidson. We'll be right back.
And now, back to your host, Bernard Alvarez.
Welcome back to the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. I'm having a wonderful talk today with Gordon Asher Davidson. We are covering, I want to thank you, Gordon, because you're synopsizing probably every show we've had in the last year. So thank you very much. I'm really enjoying it. And now, the name of your book is The Transfiguration of Our World, How a Light Alliance is Transforming Darkness and Creating a New Earth. Is the book available at Amazon, your website? Where can people find it?
Yes, it's available as printed copy or ebook on Amazon right now. And so you can easily, or anyone can easily order it. I also have a teleseminar that I'm doing along this same topic. I've done several of these, and I have a very good attendance to these. And people can actually sign up and still participate in it. It's been going I've done five sessions. There'll be more. But I have transcripts and full videos with myself speaking and all the Q&A available for the previous sessions. So if people are interested in being part of a teleseminar on this theme, it goes much deeper in it really focuses on what you can do to transform and raise your frequency. They just can go to worldtransfiguration.com. worldtransfiguration.com, that's our website, and you can sign up for the teleseminar right there on that website.
Oh, that sounds fantastic. Great. Wonderful. And again, you know, I'm so grateful that you're doing this work for humanity and doing everything possible to share this information. And being on the show today is a part of that. I want to thank you.
Thank you for your work, too. You're doing wonderful work, and I appreciate the sincerity and depth of what you are, the way you're presenting. I sense that very clearly.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Now let's talk a little bit. You know, we have, how should we say, there seems to be a, how do I say this, with a high vibrational tone to it. There seems to be some misinformation, distraction going on within even those connected to the awakening, or those connected to the awakening of humanity, whether it be through activism, whether it be through the conspiracy world, whether it be through New Age. And I'm wondering if there's any advice that you could give to our listeners as to how to maybe elevate their discernment, how to be aware of it. I've seen many people who are, well, I used to say, well, if they're charging too much money, they're probably no good. But there are some people out there that, you know, they are worth $1,000 seminar, you know. But the reality of it is that there is a lot of disinformation out there. And I wonder if there's a way that maybe you've developed for your own self to tell whether someone is being genuine or if how to avoid that trap. Because I find a great example is, I'm not going to use any names, but let's say some radio hosts or some teachers out there that still are using anger and fear and mm-hmm. distrust as a part of their spiritual development.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and yeah. I can't help but wonder if there's a way that perhaps you've developed that you could share with people how to increase their discernment or raise their clarity level when it comes to that.
I can certainly do that. This is a very important topic, and I'm actually writing a whole book on this subject right now. It's on guidance and inner what people are receiving and how to evaluate it. And it's a very important point. I think just to give it a little context, when people are opening to higher levels of consciousness and receiving inputs and information, what people don't understand is that information can come from a multitude of different levels and frequencies of energy, mm-hmm. right? And there's a kind of an assumption, well, if I'm getting something coming in, it must be higher, must be, you know, good and valuable and useful. In many cases it is, but it can also be beings and energies on the inner levels that are not particularly trying to help you. They're trying to manipulate and use you for their own purposes. They're trying to maybe even trying to create distortions and more division and separation within humanity. There are those kind of possibilities also.
Absolutely.
So it's very important to, when you're people are making those kind of contacts, to surround themselves with light, to ask for protection, to be really, really clear who you're trying to contact at what level, and really focusing on that and really making sure that you're receiving from the highest level you can. And the way I evaluate these things, and whether it's my own internal experience or it's other people presenting things, it really has to do with, I always tell people, when you receive this information or this input or this communication or hear somebody on the radio or TV or whatever it is, always look very carefully at how does it affect you? How does it make you feel? What frequency does it bring your emotional body into, or your energy body, or your mind? Does it stimulate positive thoughts and vision and hope for the future? Or does it make you fearful or, you know, paranoid or having negative attitudes towards other people and groups? You know, how does that energy that you are receiving, whether it's spoken, written, or visual, or whatever it is, or internal or external, how does that actually affect you, your system? That, in my view, is the most reliable indicator of what the quality and value is of what you are being, you know, offered or exposed to. Because my fundamental principle is the energies never lie.
Mm.
You can't fake vibrational frequency. It's either there or it isn't. So for me, the goal is you're always going for that, which is uplifting, inspiring, empowering, gives you more courage, more strength, more hope for the future, more vision. Everything that moves you in that way is going to be coming from a higher level than whatever is based on fear, paranoia, separation, and anger, whatever it is. Those are all lower frequency energies which aren't going to help you, because really what you're trying to do is raise your consciousness, raise your frequency to a higher level, right?
Yeah.
Where you can live in joy and calm and peacefulness and not have this constant fear and worry going on in your consciousness that just makes your life miserable. And people who get into this stuff, you know, can really go down the rabbit hole into a very dark conspiratorial kind of world. Yeah, where, yeah. And I'm not saying that those conspiracies do not exist, because they do.
Yes.
However, and I've done my, many years ago, I did my share of investigation of all that stuff. My conclusion was, you'll never really get to the bottom of knowing absolutely what the truth is about those things.
Yeah.
Not through external investigation. You can get the truth through internal realization, but not externally, because there's so much disinformation
yes.
to put out there
yes.
to confuse people, and one thing is made to look like something and it isn't, and something else, and it's just a huge mass of just confusion, which is part of the technique that the cabal uses, which is to keep people confused about what's the truth, who are the good guys, who are the bad guys, what's going on out there, you know? And that is part of their control mechanism. And they hire, as you probably know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people to go onto these internet chat rooms and other places and attack anything that's
oh, yeah.
positive.
Yep.
Yeah. And then people have testified, who have been hired to do these things and have done it, that this, in fact, is going on. It's going on all over the place. And so, and the scripts that they're given and all this stuff. So, you know, there is definitely dark things going. But I know people who have actually really, really, really just pretty much made themselves paralyzed with fear and
yes.
negativity by going into these worlds and just taking them all at face value. And, you know, my other fundamental principle in this issue is you really can only accept or confront or work with in a creative way with as much darkness as you have the light within you to bear it.
Wow, that's a very good observation, absolutely.
So that you don't become paralyzed or with fear or so angry or so, just distraught or depressed about all these things, because that's part of what the disinformation is trying to give you the impression of, that these forces, the dark forces, are so powerful that there's nothing you can do. They have all absolute control, blah, 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 blah. That's total nonsense. That is not true. And there's a great deal of evidence that is not true. And there's a lot of people out there putting out all kinds of information as if it were absolutely true, saying it's coming from insiders.
Yes. Yeah.
And yet, when you analyze it or look at it or feel and sense what it's saying, it's still part of a disinformation, let's lower everybody's frequency campaign.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, and I can't help but notice as well that these people, even some whistleblowers that are coming out and whatnot, the reality of it is it's only a part of the story.
That's
right. And you're getting a piece of it. You're not getting the full understanding. Like you said, you're not going to get the whole truth. You're getting one person's perception and or experience. And, you know, even a great example is dealing with the grays. What do they call them?
The grays, yeah.
The beta reticulon or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Some people have wonderful experiences. Some people have horrific experiences.
Right.
So it's like, well, which one is it? Are they the good guys? Are they the bad guys? Are some of them good or some of them bad? You know, so, you know, it's very, again, it's very experiential. We can't allow ourselves to be taken in with just one person or one radio host or one TV host or one teacher's opinion and or expression of that, because it's not going to be the ultimate truth.
Right. And just as you've said in your comment about what I'm offering, and I've had this from so many people, that what I am offering is a very synthetic, big picture overview
yeah.
of the whole situation, from very detailed what's happening with all the light workers and what's doing, what the dark side is doing, how the dark side is being neutralized and taken out, and what is going on at the highest level with the galactics and the solar system and all this. So you put it all together so you get a more comprehensive
yes.
picture, which allows you to avoid getting caught in one particular little eddy, you know, whirlpool of this particular incident or this particular situation,
yes,
which
yes.
is only a tiny particle of the whole thing.
And my favorite part is when the conspirators have conspiracies against other conspiracies.
Oh, you know? that's their undoing.
I was like, you're kidding me, right?
Yeah.
It's something to be seen. But again, you know, and I agree with you wholeheartedly. You know, you say to listen, you know, see how you feel. I usually tell people become aware of your central nervous system and how your body reacts. Your body mm-hmm. doesn't lie to you.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got to say, my discussion with you today has been very calming and very uplifting. So something's very right.
Good. Well, I'm very happy to hear that. Yes.
But,
I do hear that from people.
Yeah. And the reality of it is, again, you know, we need to – it's all right. I'm not saying it's not – it's not okay to be human and to get angry and get upset about certain things. Yes, of course,
sure.
I get outraged when, you know, some injustice in the world, but mm-hmm. it passes.
Mm-hmm.
And
exactly.
I've learned to use humor, to utilize humor when it comes to a lot of the atrocities of the cabal. It's like, oh my goodness, mm-hmm. and the whole Illuminati conspiracy and, you know, I'm like, oh yes, Beyonce is the Illuminati high priestess. You probably can't even say, you know, ISIS in Egyptian or in Kemetic.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, exactly. They co-opt. That's one of their techniques. Is they take any positive energy, name or anything, and they always co-opt it and manipulate it. You know, this is what they do. For
yes.
Everything.
Absolutely. And okay, now being that we are speaking a little bit on a conspiracy level or whatever, I can't help but wonder if maybe we might be able to put a piece together here in something, because we're talking about you're talking about the dark ones that came, you know, a long time ago. I recently had Patricia Ayan from Egypt, and she is the daughter-in-law of Hakim. He was the Kemetic wisdom keeper for generations, and he talked about the Hanuti. And the Hanuti were the first corrupt priesthood of ancient Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering where the link is with perhaps I've always thought that the Egyptian mystical teachings were a little bit alienistic, but I wonder what are your insights on that with the beginning of the quote unquote cabal, negative mm-hmm. Illuminati. Was mm-hmm. there a connection back then?
Yeah, and I wrote about this in my book, and I'll take it back, sort of start at the sort of seed point, okay? So this group of negative aliens, they were like a predatory alien race. There were only 50 of them, who at very, very early, pre-Lemuria, I don't know if you're familiar with Lemuria, even pre-Lemuria, there was some kind of a time-space anomaly. Normally, there were guardians around Earth, and Earth was intended to be a garden planet and nurture and support the evolution of every single human being and living being on the planet. That was its function, its plan, and just allow things to unfold, like the Garden of Eden. And what happened was these beings worked, because of this time-space anomaly, like a wormhole, they got into the planet, and they were able to, you know, evade the guardian. There were guardians, but they were able to evade the guardians and get into the planet. But they were discovered not very long after they got here. Okay, then there was a huge debate at the higher council levels about whether they should be allowed to stay or be removed, because they could have been removed. And it was a decision of the higher councils that they would be allowed to stay for the reasons I said earlier, that then the humanity would be faced with a choice between dark and light, and through making those choices, they would experience karma and learn and make better choices in the future. That was decided was a positive thing for our evolution. Therefore, they were allowed to remain. But as they remained, they started organizing themselves, because these aliens were very experienced in how to come into a planet and set it up and exploit the entire thing for their own benefit. They were basically like a predatory exploiter kind of race. So they began that, and they were also civilizations being created with the help of the spiritual masters and the higher, you know, the lighted side. So you had a civilization in Lemuria, which had its positive aspects, but then these beings were able to always, this is their way they work, they were able to begin to influence the leadership, the priests, or whatever who the leader were, or the masses, and corrupt them, move them towards more and more selfishness and greed and all that kind of thing. That happened in Lemuria, and then there was a battle between Lemuria and the Atlantean civilization, ultimately, and the Atlantean civilization started out very beautiful and positive and was for very long periods of time, and then was corrupted again by these forces, and the Atlantean civilization ultimately attacked the Lemurian civilization, and there was a great battle. And many of the Lemurian, but the Lemurian continued, Lemurian civilization continued in its own way. And that's part of what's at the center of the Earth. It's a whole another story. So then they corrupted the priesthood of Atlantis. Atlantis became so, and then he started using all kinds of psychic weapons and crystals and psychic warfare. And the whole civilization became so corrupted that it was decided at a higher, again, at a higher level, that this civilization had to be eliminated because it was not redeemable. It was too corrupted. So the initiates of the time were told this was coming. They left Atlantis, went to all these other locations in Tibet and in Egypt and other places around the world, South America, and left. And then civilization and Atlantis was destroyed. And that was the Great Flood. In all the traditions, you find that information, right? So then they started in Tibet. They had a very highly, many of the positive spiritual leadership of these from Tibet, and from Atlantis, moved to all these different locations, started very high civilizations, went on for some extended period of time. But again, the corrupting influences came in, and this is true in Egypt. And as well in South America. And then in South America, it turned into human sacrifice. In Egypt, the priesthood was corrupted and became, an exploitive kind of corrupting force. And they assassinated the great higher spiritual being.
Yeah.
Who were the real spiritual leaders of those civilizations. And in Tibet, it held out for much longer. But there is a certain dark side of Tibet, too. But it's not as prominent as it is has been in other of these, sort of descendant civilizations. So then in the current cycle, they came out in, as we colonized the United States, which was a tremendous, even though the treatment of the native people was ghastly, the impulse to create a new continent in the United States, the New Atlantis, was called by Francis Bacon, was done, and that became, we've done a lot of study and presentations on the spiritual heritage and destiny of America. That's one of our specialties. And then that unfolded as it did in a very positive way, and the Declaration and the Constitution were all hugely important in the evolution of humanity and our political systems. And then, but there again, they came in and they've been involved in trying to influence and corrupt the system. And the 1913 Federal Reserve Act was one of their primary means.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And that they came back in and got, even though they were defeated in the war, World War II, and the Nazi Axis powers, was another way to try to gain control of the planet and turn it into a slave place. Slave camp, the whole planet, and they were defeated with the help of the Galactics, but the dark forces were not removed from the planet. They were driven onto the astral plane and sealed behind what's called the door where evil dwells. That door was sealed, and most of the human cooperators with them were arrested, killed, neutralized, or whatever. But they remained, and the task of humanity after the war was to keep that door closed, so that by not indulging in greed and selfishness and all those things, so that their evil energies and influences could not find a foothold in humanity. Unfortunately, humanity did not do that, and they reemerged after the war, and slowly built up again their control systems, and then it has just since. And since the 50s and 60s, that control and those systems have just accelerated in their intensity and full grip on all the systems of our civilization. And especially in the last 20 to 30 years, it's really, really been intensive, the growth in their control.
Absolutely. I can't help but think about what was it, Eisenhower's farewell speech, warning us about that.
Absolutely, he was a very lighted being. He was, and so, you know, that all that has led up to. I mean, the plan, as you probably know, was to reduce the population of the Earth by 80%, mm-hmm. so that it would be easier to control humanity. And that was going to be done, they wanted to try to start a nuclear war between Iran and the United States, or Iran and Israel, and they also tried various things. Did you remember the SARS virus?
Oh, yeah.
Big deal. Whole big deal. Oh, SARS virus is going to wipe out, be huge worldwide epidemic. And 1 week later, it's completely off the charts, off the media. Why?
Yeah.
Because the Galactics neutralized it.
Yeah, I can't help but notice the same thing about this Ebola scare.
Exactly.
Like, it was all in our face, and then it's gone.
Exactly. And it's the same in with the nuclear radiation from Fukushima. The Galactics are neutralizing all that. They're also neutralizing the chemtrails. So all that stuff is being handled because part of the decree that came down after 9/11 was that the Galactics would protect humanity from any more major false flag events like 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
And because of the level of consciousness and the technologies that they have, because they're extremely advanced compared to our little primitive civilization, they actually know exactly everything that the Cabal ever thinks of doing almost at the moment they think of it.
Right, right.
So there's no way they can hide anything. They also know exactly where all the treasure that the Cabal has looted from humanity for the last, you know, thousands of years, which is, you know, quintillions of dollars worth of gold and diamonds and everything stored away in caves in the mountains. Well, they know where every last penny of that is, and there's no way they can hide it. And when the time comes, all that treasure is going to be made available to humanity. That's part of how we are going to be able to regenerate the entire planet. And one of the main focuses is going to be on rebuilding, purifying and regenerating the environmental systems of our planet. That is going to be the major focus for the whole world.
Yeah, and absolutely. It's going to have to be.
It has to be. And, if we have free energy, then you can set up desalinization plants anywhere in the world. And what happens? You can turn the Middle East into a garden again, which it mm-hmm. was. And that will happen. That's part of the plan. And so all those, you know, 40-50% unemployed young people in the Arab world or the Middle East who don't have anything to do or no prospects of marriage or anything else, so they all become jihadists, will now have a positive purpose, something to work with that gives them dignity, self-respect, income, capacity to have meaningful lives, including getting married, having children, and all the rest of it. That's why we have so much insanity. One of the reasons we have so much craziness in the Middle East. We have millions and millions of young Arab, especially men, young men who have no hope of a decent life.
Yeah.
No political participation, no economic opportunity, no hope for getting married, and there they are. What are they going to do? They're all crazy with testosterone. They got to find something to do.
And I can't help but notice that even on a political level, the idea of the United States in the Middle East, and I don't even think it's really the idea of the United States. It's the idea of westernizing or becoming addicted to Western monetary ways of living, kind of like what Chavez was doing. Castro didn't do a very good job of it, but these countries that are trying to keep out the centralized banking,
mm-hmm.
and these people are very passionate about it. They're like, we don't want this here.
Of course not. No,
and I can't help but that adds to some of the frustration of these young Arab men.
Certainly, and that certainly does, and they know that there is a lot of control and corruption coming from the West, and especially from the United States. And right now, on this planet, the Cabal control is still most woven into the system in the United States compared to anywhere else, unfortunately. But there's a lot going on.
Right.
One of the things is the military. What's happening, and this is there's a lot of evidence I can share with you about this, So, you know, the military, the whole thing about nuclear weapons has been, by the way, part of the decree from the solar level was that there will be no nuclear war on this planet. There will be no nuclear exchanges. That is never going to happen on this planet. And it has been in place for a long time. But that's definitely not an option. So, but one of the ways that the Cabal has maintained control is through the military, because they had control over the nuclear weapon system. And one of their threats was, the Cabal knew that the Galactics were the primary threat to their power and control of this planet.
Hold that thought, Gordon. We got to take a break, and we'll be right back.
And now, back to your host, Bernard Alvarez.
Welcome back to the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. We are speaking today with Gordon Asher Davidson. And just before the break, Gordon, we were talking about the military and about how the light beings are not going to allow a nuclear war to happen on our planet. What's changing with the military?
Yes. Okay. I wanted to just put this in a little bit bigger context.
Yes, please.
For a moment, because I think it's important. You know, there's one of the areas that so many people are so frustrated about is the way all the information about contact with higher civilizations, UFOs, and ET experiences, and all these things have been so suppressed for such a long period of time. Now, that's not just whimsical. This is very much because the Cabal knew and knows that the biggest threat to their power on this planet was galactic civilizations, because they were the primary power that had the capacity to break down their systems and change the whole game and get them and knock them out of power. And so there has been this very carefully orchestrated campaign, which with many facets. One of the facets is to make sure any information about sightings or experiences with a UFO craft or other experiences about contact with other civilizations is completely suppressed and ridiculed. That's been going on for decades and decades. The second thing is they have carefully designed a huge number of movies, TV shows, and stories about how aliens are going to come and kill you, eat you, and destroy our planet. And that is also a carefully orchestrated campaign to keep humanity afraid of contact with other civilizations for that reason, to not allow them to gain, for humanity to look to them as any kind of source of help or higher anything.
And let me interrupt you for one moment. I just want to ask you, the conspiracy of Operation Bluebeam is also participating in that, where they're going to do this false flag alien salvation thing, and then really they're going to kill us all. Or I don't know if you know anything about it, but it seems to be going around.
Yeah, I'm familiar. It's like a virus that's going around.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I had to throw that in there because it's all.
No, it's fine. You can put in anything you want. That's, again, another example of that kind of activity, which is that will never, ever be allowed to happen by the Galactics, the true Galactics. That, even though they may, the Cabal seems to have reverse engineered some versions of UFO craft, at least that's what I haven't really verified this through my inner process, but it seems like that's probably the case. But they will never be allowed to fake an alien invasion, because that is completely counter to the entire plan of the Light Alliance. It will not happen, and it hasn't happened. I mean, the thing I always like to say to people, so many people have all these horrible scenarios that they mapped out about the future, right? You know, alien invasion, huge Earth changes, pole shifts. I mean, it's gone on for decades and decades. And what I was told is I need to remind people about all the predictions that have never come true.
Yep.
And it's very important to people to see that. And by all predictions, and I live in California, we all should be underwater here, even including Edgar Cayce.
Yeah.
But the fact of the matter is, we're not. And most of these horrible things have not happened. and they are not going to happen. And that's really key, is for people to gain a little bit more sense of security. And but that's all part of trying to keep the subconscious in fear so that people will be easy to manipulate. Anyway, so now to go back to the military.
Yeah.
The one of the ways that the Cabal has been able to hold off, in a way, the further explicit communication between the Galactics and humanity is a threat that they had put out, that if they did do that, if the Galactics came in contact with humanity, they would unleash nuclear weapons on humanity. The Cabal would. As that was the threat that they would have been using for a long time to try to keep the Galactics from
right.
You know, really contacting us. But very interesting is that the military in the United States has steadily been turned to the light. And it is now, my information is, it's up in the 90%+ level, are all oriented towards the light. And I don't know if you're aware, but the CIA was raided about couple months ago,
mm-hmm.
and they have a new director at the CIA, and all that was, and it's now under the control of the Pentagon, which is part of the process. The other thing that happened in October of 2013, the U.S. Air Force general in charge of all of the nuclear missiles, General Michael Carey, and the U.S. Naval Admiral with the top nuclear weapons responsibilities, Vice Admiral Tim Giardina, were both fired. And the threat of unleashing, the Cabal's threat of unleashing nuclear disaster on humanity was neutralized.
Hmm.
This is very important.
Right.
Extremely important. And more, and what I am getting is that the top leadership of the Pentagon is now completely aligned with the Light Alliance. Which is a very different view than a lot of people hold about the military.
That's definitely a big pill for me to swallow as well.
I know, and it's okay. I mean, but they had there was a big flurry on the internet not too long ago about how the military was massing a lot of tanks and all kinds of equipment around in Texas, around where the Bushes live.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you hear about that?
Yeah.
Well, that, in my view, was a little message to the Bush family.
Right, right.
That's, and the Bush family is one of the leaders of the Cabal.
You know, and one of the things I've got to say, and again, I don't get very political because it's just too frustrating, and it upsets my mm-hmm. central nervous system. Mm-hmm. But I will say I was pleasantly surprised at Obama's remarks on the reelection of Netanyahu. I was like, wow, a U.S. president for the first time ever speaking out against that man who's doing apartheid in Palestine, you know. But I was like, wow, very, very interesting.
Yes.
Very interesting.
Well, Obama, of course, is one of the more controversial figures in terms of people trying to figure out who he's working with. But he is definitely working with the Light Alliance. There's no doubt about that. And there was an intention during his first term, where he was, the plan was that the Cabal members were going to resign and allow the Light Alliance to take over the positions in the different control systems, and actually Obama would help with this transition. That plan did not happen because did not happen, and then people refused to do that.
I think his entire cabinet was made up of members of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is one of the darker alliances.
And
so they moved right in. They probably threatened them every other day: do this, or we'll kill your family. For all we know.
Oh, no doubt. But Obama actually has protection at an extremely high level, and they will not be. Otherwise, he would have been killed by now, probably. But he has this incredible level of protection. Anyway, so now what's so interesting is in the last, what's been about 3 or 4 months, all of a sudden Obama is on steroids. And he's coming out with one thing after another. Really, what he's doing is he's presenting the vision of what is the new way of, you know, the way forward for the United States and even the world, in some cases, for how we handle these issues, like immigration, like the environment, like pollution. There's so many things that he has put forward. The net neutrality, he saved that.
Yeah, that was unbelievable. I can't believe that passed.
Yeah, exactly. And all these things are, and is boosting of solar energy, and all the things he's been doing, which are extremely important, and they show a picture of where we need to be going. He even has advocated increasing taxes on the wealthy. And he's put out this whole protecting more and more pristine areas of the ocean and the earth, and with all this things they've been passing about preserving different areas. All that is exactly the agenda of the Lead Alliance. There's no way you can,
right.
Even though he hasn't performed the way we had hoped or initially, and what that tells me, the fact what he's doing now is he's, and I do believe he is in touch with the Lead Alliance, he's been given the go-ahead to go ahead and do everything he knows should be done. Even if it doesn't pass, it's putting it out there as the direction, the vision of where we need to go.
Yeah, and being that this is his last term, he's got that opportunity on political level to get away with it and move on, do the best that he can.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I can't help but want to ask you because and it's stirring within me, and I'm sure many of our listeners are wondering the same question. We're talking, we were talking earlier about the place in the birth of America. Mm-hmm. You know, of course, in the conspiracy circles, the Freemasons are very untrusted. Mm-hmm. I personally have a problem with them, but for my own reasons. But that's different. I wouldn't want to become one. But I, you know, everyone has their place. The reality of it is that it's been said that they were infiltrated to the point of complete corruption. Even Obama is a Freemason, as well as many of the leaders of the world, and many members of the cabal are members of particular secret societies and whatnot. And I'm not saying there aren't Light Alliance secret societies. I've participated in many secret societies that were very positive.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering where has that started to change a little bit? Are we seeing the negative aspects of the Illuminati being pulled out? Are we seeing the Freemasons going back to their original purpose, mm-hmm. on a whole? Again, you know, all of these. Are coming to mind as we're talking about the transition, like the Pentagon and Washington, and for that to happen, it's going to have to happen pretty drastically.
yes, certainly. Well, my understanding is anywhere where cabal members are, you know, active, they will be either removed or, with this shift in energy, they will just simply not be functional any longer in terms of being able to cause the
mayhem,
mayhem, and disaster, and for everyone else in control. Yes, that will be removed. And, you know, I've always had this sense personally that there needed to be something happen on this planet where there was a sorting based on consciousness, right? You know, like if you can have a natural disaster, that's not going to do that. You could even have a plague or something. That wouldn't necessarily do it either. Not that I want any of those things to happen, and I never did. But how would this actually ever happen, that you could have the people who are meant to stay here and create the new world be here, and those who weren't would not? And this is the only way that it's come to me that this is what is going to happen. This is raising the frequency to such a level that unless you meet that level of frequency, you can't be here. And that really works pretty well in terms of clarifying all these issues. And rather than them having to, you know, because they used to, and this is interesting in the evolution of what I've been receiving. Originally, it was they were going to be mass arrests, and all these people were going to be, you know, arrested and tried and go through.
Right. Well, I heard about that. Yeah.
I'm sure you've heard about that. What I've been getting for quite a while now is that there may be some arrests, but it's not going to be like a mass thing.
Right.
It's not necessary, because it won't be necessary, because if the frequency of the planet reaches a certain stage, those people will not be able to continue to control the system, and they will just simply not be an issue. And that is the way the transition's really going to happen. So that would be true within the Freemasons. It would be true within every organization that exists, including the media and everything else. Right. And I think that to me makes a lot of sense, because otherwise, if you had to go through and step by step eliminate, you know, every person who was a problem, that could take, you know, decades and decades.
Yes, yes, yeah. And arrest everybody, because God knows there's probably a million of them out there. You know?
Oh, yes.
No, I can't help but see the parallels, and I kind of align with this idea. What you're describing sounds very similar to I don't know if you saw the film, the actual film of the Celestine Prophecy, not the book, but the film.
Yes, I did.
And that moment where they move into the new light world, and they couldn't be seen by the police. You know, the guys that were trying to kill them, they became invisible to them.
Yes.
And
yes.
Those guys got stuck on that earth, and they moved on to the light planet, you know. And I'm wondering if it's kind of like that kind of thing. That's what I'm imagining it like.
Yes, exactly. That was a real reasonable depiction of the whole concept. Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, and it's so funny, I always think of this in terms of the idea of the rapture. You must be familiar with that.
I was a part of we were making fun of that, and we were putting, like, clothes on out in the front lawn the day that the rapture was going to happen.
Well, what's so interesting to me is that the actual reality that's emerging is that those people who cannot move into the higher frequency will be taken off the planet and placed in environments exactly resonant with their frequency, which some of which are not places I would want to go for a vacation. And the people who are able to move to the higher frequency will stay here, go through a shift into higher consciousness while remaining in their bodies and still have a body and be here and contributing to the whole regeneration of the earth.
You know, isn't that karma? Christians are going to have their rapture, but they're not going somewhere nice.
Yeah. Well, I think it's very interesting, because the reality is, in our universe, you know, karma is constant, and you cannot escape the effects of it. And in everything is measured in vibrational frequency. That's how the galactics operate. That's how all of these higher civilizations operate. So if there are practicing fundamentalist Christians who probably do live in a higher love frequency.
Right, and a Christ-like.
There are many beautiful people who believe in those things. Their beliefs may be a little limited, but their actual frequency is
high
because they do practice love. And then there are fundamentalists who are using their system of beliefs to control, manipulate, and extort money out of poor, innocent people, and very cynical. And we've seen plenty of evidence of that. And they will not be able to resonate at that higher level.
Isn't that the truth? I've been meaning to ask you this during the entire conversation, but I'm hoping we're going to have enough time. We've only got about 10 minutes left, not even. Have they spoken to you, or what is your take on the biblical God of Yahweh? Is he an alien? Why is he so angry? You know, what happened there? Was that a part of controlling?
I've never actually specifically investigated that question with my inner contact, but I think in the context of that time, with the ancient Jewish dispensation and others, there was this concept that God had to be appeased, that God was angry with us. And therefore, the only way to make that deal with that was to have sacrifice, and Abraham, Isaac, and all the traditional stories about that. And I think it was definitely more a projection of the state of human consciousness at that time. And there could have been, and I've never really looked into this very deeply, beings or entities who were using that concept to stimulate sacrifice, whether it's animals or human beings, and we know that happened in Central America, using that concept to stimulate, appeasing the gods through sacrifice as a way to promote bloodletting and all these horrible practices, which the dark entities feed on that kind of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And that, so they were probably involved in that as well, you know, in the concept of sacrifice, and they used to in the Yahweh pretty much comes out of the Jewish tradition, and they never really, for the most part, except maybe with the myth of Abraham and Isaac and all that, but and not really gotten into human sacrifice, but there was massive amounts of animal sacrifice.
Yes, bulls and sheep and lambs and
everything. Yeah.
But burnt offerings, I remember reading about that.
Yeah. I'm glad I wasn't around to smell that.
Oh, no, exactly. But
yeah.
It's just amazing how, and then of course, you know, the dark cabal comes in and takes over that as a religion and uses it to manipulate humanity.
Mm-hmm. as most of them happen. And when I think that's a great point to mention Pope Francis, because Pope Francis is a key player in the Light Alliance.
He's doing something right. Yes, he is.
Oh, yeah. He's a key player. And he has really done a tremendous amount to liberate and move against all the darkness that the Vatican was a central point of, especially the financial system, the Vatican Bank itself, which was one of the key anchor points for the whole control of the financial system by the cabal.
Yeah.
And he's now removed all the directors, has put in a professional management. They are doing a massive audit. They've even revealed that they found all this hidden money there that nobody realized.
Oh, yeah, the mafia's not very happy with him.
No. And he's done a tremendous amount. And he's calling for, he's talking about pollution as a crime against humanity. He's talking about, the whole system of slavery and human trafficking. They organized a meeting with hundreds of church leaders, really condemning trafficking in all forms of slavery and demanding and get it removed by 2020, which hopefully is going to happen before that.
Yeah.
But you know, his whole approach and the energies that he has working through him are just phenomenal, and he's having a worldwide impact.
Well,
and one of
Gordon, I'm very sorry. We only got about 10 more seconds left, so we need to wrap this up.
I really
enjoyed our conversation today. Can you give us a website where people can find out more about you?
Yes, it's www.worldtransfiguration.com. And everything is there.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. And everybody, we will see you next week. We love you very, very much. Thank you for listening today.